All right, let's call the meeting of January 23rd to order, and we'll start with Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All righty then, what do we got, Chris? Manifests.
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 Okay. So I forgot my glasses.
Nice.
Are you reading?
Yeah.
What power?
One.
One and a half,
and I'll go buggy by the end of the night. Tyler's got it. I need to make the motion.
Make a motion. We approve the manifest for a payment of 1/17/2017 and also 1/16/2017.
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Anything else?
No.
Approval, anything in here?
Nothing that needs approval, no.
Pass that to Tyler, please. Is there one of these for each of us?
No.
No.
The county snapshot of the county budget.
Yep. Nice if I brought a pen that writes. Okay. There you go. Minutes. Minutes of 1/9. I think, Dawn, you got comments from everybody, right?
Tyler, did you have any changes?
Nope.
Yes.
All right, I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes from 1/9/2017 as amended.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I just found another one, Chris. All right, minutes approved.
Not getting my good one.
I'm very particular about my pens as well, and I hide them from my family. Okay. Boards and committees. Budget.
Budget committee. It was a long meeting, the last one, but everything got done.
But that was a public hearing on the school budget?
Yes. There wasn't really a lot of people here, only you.
How did it go?
It went well. I mean, lasted for a while, but
were there any significant discussions about the school budget?
No.
Was the budget approved as what the school board presented?
Yeah, there was one. We had one change on here somewhere. We had changed the when they do their numbers or whatever, they had so much money stipend for new students, new high school students. And they, I believe the first number they had was $91,026, and there was a motion and it was seconded to decrease that to $75,000.
So by $20,000. That was for the assumption of tuition for new students
new
coming in.
New high school students,
yep.
So that was the only change.
Okay.
But everything, all the warrant articles that they put in, they all went through.
Okay. Anything?
We had a public hearing as well for the warrant articles. Zero people showed up. And the case that we heard is continued. So nothing earth-shattering.
All right. No other boards and committees, so town administrator report?
I don't have too much that we're not going to cover later. The legislature is back in business, which rarely is a good thing for us. But we're watching a couple things now. Nothing that you need to act on yet, I don't think. But one is another tinkering with the utility assessment. House Bill 324 would basically wipe out the local assessment of utility properties and have DRA do it for everybody. That's in committee and in the House right now. It would cost us an assessed value, probably something in the neighborhood of $6 million if it were to go forward. I don't know if it has legs or not, but we're keeping an eye on that one. And there's all one that's getting a lot of press, I don't know if it's actually got any legs, is the doing away with the concealed carry permit, which is a, you know, we do a couple hundred a year maybe of those in town. So it would impact us in a workload and a revenue, you know, at $10 a piece or whatever.
Meaning that people won't need a permit for...
They won't need it, yeah.
Right, they would, yes, they would not need a permit to conceal and carry.
Okay.
So it's just a regulation going away, essentially.
Okay. My understanding is that it's probably going to pass.
Yeah. I think, did it get through the House already?
Yeah.
So it, that'll go to the Senate, and it looks like it's going to pass, but I don't. That's just, it's a work thing for us more than, you know, we don't have a policy concern. In your packet, you should have something that looks like this. This is a tabulation of the recycling business. As we get to year end, it's a good time to catch up with our tracking of all those things. There's no big news, but I just wanted to kind of keep you updated on the trends. Volume is up slightly in both recyclable materials and waste, which is pretty consistent for the last few years. That top chart you have is a total volume that we processed.
So the expense materials and the revenue materials, can you just explain those?
Yep. Expense materials are things we pay to get rid of.
Yeah.
And revenue materials are things that we sell.
So does that...
Recyclable materials that we sell.
Okay.
The mix between them hasn't changed very much. You see, historically, this changes in 2013 and 14. 2014 is the first full year of a three-day schedule at the center, so that would explain the drop there.
Yeah.
And the change in—that's a change in use. That's other people finding other ways to deal with their waste as a result of that change. I can't think of any other explanation other than that. And then we return. 14, 15, 16, return to the slow growth that you would expect with slow increase in population, you know, typical development pace. It doesn't look like usage patterns have really changed since that switch to a three-day schedule overall. We're seeing a little bit more in bulky waste and demo materials.
What's MSW?
Municipal solid waste. That's the compactor.
Okay.
That's everything goes. Electronics is up too. It doesn't really show on this chart just because of its volume, but it has jumped a little bit. The demo, the bulky waste and demo stuff is. It's costly to get rid of. It's the cost of it, getting rid of it is going up, and the volume is going up, and that's pushing our totals more than anything. Our revenue from that shows up, you know, as we charge people for throwing those things away on a by truck basis.
Yep.
That's up a little bit as well. It, that's a, you know, to get a straight line comparison from one to the other is tough, but you know, when you're charging people by the pickup truck full or the half pickup truck full, it's not an exact science. It's not going to go by weight.
Yep.
Very well.
So the third chart, revenue materials volume, is that a more detailed view of the revenue?
Yes.
Up in the first chart?
Yep. The second one is a breakdown of the red. The third one is a breakdown of the green.
Yeah.
No great surprises there. The plastics number bounces around, and I think that has something to do with the amount that we store before we sell. If you look year to year, it's a hard thing to track because we stockpile so much of it that the this tracking system is all based on when it's shipped out, not when it comes in the door.
Yeah.
So but overall, you know, you can see it, 2015 looked like a real busy year in plastics, but 14 and 16 look a little quiet. It all middles out, and it's pretty constant. Cardboard is jumping. We hear that from the folks working there. They feel like they're moving a lot more cardboard, and we're seeing it in the numbers. That is, I would assume, more
Amazon
business.
That's exactly what I was.
Yeah, you see the cardboard.
Too.
There's a lot of Amazon cardboard going through.
Yeah.
To be expected. So that's the volume side of things. The second page is more the dollars. This is what we're spending to get rid of it, both to pay to get ship it and to haul it and to dispose of it.
Yep.
This is where you see the big change in the bulky waste C&D in that first chart. That trend is pushing our costs up broadly. Not a huge number, but it's moving the number.
Mm-hmm.
The second chart, recycling revenue, while our volume goes up, the market is horrible for resale of those materials. We're making very little on selling any of it. We're not alone there. It's just the nature of the market. There's more of the stuff available and less of it being demanded. So
what's the disposal savings that you're showing?
If you were to take the weight of the recycled materials and throw it in the MSW, if you didn't recycle it, you just threw it away, that's the extra that you would pay to get rid of it.
So the
real benefit of recycling, more so now than in the past, is not selling the stuff, it's keeping it out of the landfill.
Okay.
The monetary value is keeping it out of that MSW where we pay $80 a ton to get rid of it.
Right.
So, you know, to really fairly show what the, you know, if you didn't recycle, if you just threw everything in the trash, that's what it would cost you.
Walk me through one of these. So in 2016.
Okay, so in 2016, we generated, call it $6,000 in metal and cans revenue, the darkest green.
Yep.
$5,000 in paper and cardboard, selling the cardboard and paper that we recycle, and $2,000 in plastics. Just real.
Sure.
Right.
Yep.
If you take the weight of all those combined.
Yep.
The green here is dollars, but if you took the same weight and you paid to throw it away in the landfill, the cost of throwing it away would be that dotted green bar at the top. So we say if it's a one for one, then that's what we save in disposal costs by recycling. You got?
Okay.
The dotted green at the top is all of those things put together. If instead of sorting them and selling them, we just compacted them and buried them, we would pay another 10, 20, 30,000.
Okay. I guess I find that to be an odd chart because it's combining revenues and expenses.
It's expenses that you're not incurring. It's not cash, but it's savings. And I did that because I didn't want you to look at recycling and say, we only make $15,000 from all that work that we do on recycling.
Sure, sure.
Because we...
Sure.
Yes, we only take in $15,000 in cash for all the work that everybody does in sorting all the cans and crushing them and packing them up and shipping them away, and every resident that has to do all that work. The value of that is not just the $15,000 in cash that we get.
Yep.
It's the $30,000 in savings that we...
Yeah, so it's actually more like a net value.
Yes.
Than a net revenue. Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
And the bottom one is the red and the green put together. And the solid black line is the total cost of dealing with all the material that we take in. Whether we sell it, bury it, whatever we do with it. So what that's telling us is that it's the material side of our recycling business, not the facility operation, not the payroll, but the material side of it, costs us about $20,000 more in 16 than it did in 14. I don't see that trend reversing unless something changes in the recycling market or something changes in how we charge for the service.
Does this ever go in the town report?
No, this is a different look than what has appeared in the past.
Okay.
What has appeared in the town report is mostly a, we did this many pounds of plastic, this many pounds of whatever.
Because I think it's good data. I don't think it's self-explanatory.
Yeah, and then we can tinker with it if we want to change what we present.
Yeah.
So anyway, that is the year in review.
Okay.
And I think that is all I have in this category.
So there was some changes made, right? We got like two trucks or something like that to store materials, so when the price is right, we...
Yeah, we're doing more of the, it's not so much trying to time the market as it is save on hauling costs,
right,
for half loads.
Yeah.
Because you're paying by the trip for a big chunk of the hauling cost is just per trip. So if you have a full trailer, great, then you cut your hauling cost in half. We don't watch the market that closely and say, okay, I've got 3/4 of a trailer and it's a good week for selling plastic. We don't watch that. It doesn't move that fast.
Yeah, right. I was going to ask if it fluctuates that much.
So I don't think that it fluctuates enough to make it worth trying to micromanage it to that level. I don't think that would pay for itself.
And do we know how many people use it based on the permits that get issued or the stickers that get issued?
That's not as good an indicator as it used to be because you now need that same sticker to go to the beach. So we have a lot of beach users that may not use the recycling center. We purchased more stickers, distributed a lot more stickers in 16 than we ever have because we're putting them in with renewals that are done by mail, and so that in itself doesn't tell you much. And that was always a, you know, how many vehicles do you bring to the dump?
Right.
It's really what you were measuring there. It wasn't measuring users. So we don't have a good measure of visits or households. We don't have any source of that data.
I mean, the unfortunate thing is when you look at the total volume, right, on that first chart. So when we switched the hours, when the hours decreased, right, we lost, there was that tonnage, right, that those folks may have recycled that now no longer recycle, because I don't think any of the trash haulers curbside do recycling, right? It all goes into the landfill.
Right.
That's the one unfortunate thing.
Yeah, our recycling revenue didn't, our recycling volume didn't drop as precipitously as our waste volume, but it did drop.
The other thing that would be interesting to see is on kind of that wood bulky waste stuff, if it at all correlates with any like building permits that may or may not have been issued, like are people rehabbing And so they're coming and they're getting rid of that.
Yeah, that's it. That I can lay that. I know the, which flavors of permit. You wouldn't see it not necessarily with a new construction permit, but a renovation permit.
But with a yeah.
Yeah, I can. I'll take a look at that, and I would expect that those correlate a little bit.
Yeah.
You mean you're talking like someone doing something without getting the permit and all that, or
no? That do get a permit. Oh, you know, who knows? Yeah. Without, you know, we don't know without getting the permit, but you know, the deck comes down, a new deck goes up, and
yep.
Or how much is, you know, that, or it would just be, and I mean, I know that they try and crunch that stuff down so that, you know, it gets smaller versus we're hauling a truck that's,
With this stuff, it's the disposal cost more than the hauling, but they both cost. So yeah, they pack them in as much as they can. Yeah. But where we really get dinged out is the, per ton cost to get rid of it. Yeah.
And I guess the other thing is you know, how much it would be interesting in not to do it now, but you know, at some point, what are other towns costing charging? I think this was probably looked at a few years ago as far as what other charges.
Couple years ago,
yeah, it was they when they made that change, they made a whole lot of changes
lot
all
of changes.
At once,
yeah.
And did that exercise, and then we tweaked a couple things 2, maybe 3 years ago, and really the only thing that matters in dollars is that bulky waste and sand.
Bulky waste,
everything else, you know, whether it's batteries or light bulbs or whatever, electronics, even it, the volume is so low that you could. You could triple the price and you wouldn't, you know, or cut it in half and it wouldn't. But the C&D one, where we're so unscientific about how we do it, because you kind of have to be, you know, it's a little subjective, but short of having a scale, which is the next step, and really charging by the pound like we pay to get rid of it by the pound. I don't know, you know, it's hard to rely on the data beyond that because we don't have it. You know, a scale is a, I'd be surprised if it ever paid for itself if you ever went through that exercise. You might scare off some users, which can be a good thing and a bad thing. It would probably, you know, the service implications would be pretty significant. It would cost a bunch of money. So where we're configured the way we are now, I don't know that a scale makes sense, but that's the next logical step. And if we keep seeing a huge increase in this bulky waste and C&D, we're gonna have to do something differently because we're probably not recovering the full cost of it.
Right.
Nor do I think they intended to recover the full cost. I mean, it's just, it's the cost of doing business. But,
I find it amazing because there's been like so many houses built on my street in the last like year or so, and we're like 2 miles from the dump, and they use curbside or half dumpsters.
Oh, the people that have moved in.
Yeah.
No, it's a hassle. It's a, you know.
It's fun.
A lot of scuttlebutt down there at the dump.
I know. I wish there was a way that we could have curbside recycling pickup.
I looked at, I talked with NRRA, it must have been last year, about what would be possible in terms of having a truck for recycling materials, you know, like to put a truck up by the lake a couple days a week.
Right.
And you can bring your recyclables there or whatever.
Yep.
It would be, in terms of owning a truck, it wouldn't even come close to working.
Sure.
I looked at what our neighboring towns had for equipment just to see if, you know, maybe there's nothing really. I didn't get very far with it. It's the numbers are hard, and we don't have the capability to empty such a truck. You know, if you took in cardboard, you'd have to unload the truck by hand and put the cardboard in our baler, and it would be.
How does Raymond do it? Because they all put out.
Raymond's got curbside with single stream, I think.
Okay.
They might have gone to single stream, but they have curbside for both, and they have a transfer station that's available to them, to their residents on a fee basis. I think it's privately managed.
Okay.
The transfer station is privately managed?
I think there's a private entity involved in it somehow. Yeah, because the vast majority of their volume is handled with curbside. Yeah. They looked at curbside when they stuck their toe in the water with curbside pickup when they made the changes at the recycling center, and I'm sure it came back astronomically.
I don't see how curbside would be cost effective for
so
many roads on this.
Well, I know. The path that you were going down is, you know, once a month recycling, you know, in other parts of town or in the distant parts of town.
I know some of the companies that are doing like dumpster service now. I think it's, you know, due to them having to sort it all out. Like at my work there, they had just one dumpster for the long. Now they've come to a recyclable dumpster and.
Oh, really?
Like, yeah.
Huh. Which is opposite of single stream.
No, you're saying you have one single stream recycling dumpster and
yeah, one dumpster for recycling.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, single stream is great, but I don't think the cost. I think you say it's a little less expensive than disposing of waste, but it's a net cost. You know,
we looked at it like a few years ago before you, I think, and it wasn't cost effective for what we do.
Right.
But
no, nor would it be, you know, to just get out of the sorting business at our recycling center and just have two dumpsters, you know, that wouldn't be anything close to cost effective either. It'd be convenient, but it would cost a substantial amount.
So the people that pick up the curbside have the service, where are they getting rid of it? In Nottingham?
No, they take it direct to Turnkey, I think, up in Rochester, yeah. And I don't know is what the charge for that is these days with the private services in town.
It's $25 a month.
A month? Yeah, so.
Well, they make money.
Only one guy, too. One guy and one lady that does it, the whole thing.
Yeah.
Price of gas right now is cheap.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. Any other questions or?
No, I can further discuss this after town meeting.
Yeah. Nothing else going on.
All right. Right on time.
How do you know?
Chief. Hey, Chief. Come on up.
Can I put a computer in?
I've got your PowerPoint. You want me to run it for you?
I got pictures.
All right. Come on up.
Yeah. Good evening. Deputy Chief.
What should I grab? VGA?
Yep, right here.
Sorry to hold your meeting up here.
That's okay. You're right on time.
A little slippery.
Yeah, I wouldn't have been surprised if you'd been called out on other business. But
time will tell.
Way to go.
Time will tell.
We do want to try to get the board out of here sooner rather than later tonight because of the weather.
I'll give you a ride home. How's that?
Perfect.
Not on this.
Oh.
Is it showing?
There we go.
Should find it, right, guys?
Chris, in the meantime, thank you for this.
Yeah, Don does actually most of the work because it's
thank
a nightmare to track all that stuff.
Thank you, Don.
I just take the results and make them look pretty. But
Well, then I guess that makes you guys a good team.
Nope.
Try You got a function on your keyboard there with the
Absolutely.
Second display or whatever, which is probably F4, function F4 or something like that.
Function 4?
Yeah, look at your keys.
There we go. Something's going on.
Yep.
There we go. Thank you, sir. Light show. I believe we're here to talk about the ambulance, correct?
Correct.
Good evening. My name is Jay Vilchuk, Chief of Nottingham Fire Rescue. Deputy Chief Macker is here with me.
Good.
We're going to talk about 2017 ambulance replacement. Background, as you know, Nottingham has one ambulance. Typically, we replace it every 4 to 5 years. The more time I get under my belt, the more I see that we have mechanical issues that tend to arise during the 4th to 5th year. 2008, 2013, this will be the third ambulance we purchased while I was chief, okay? If it goes through, all right? Replacement strategy, like I said, is every 4 to 5 years. I have a picture there that's Barnstead. Barnstead, this is what we're talking about, is a type 1 replacement. We currently have a type 3. I'll give you some technicals. Type 1 is on a truck chassis. Type 3 is on a cutaway van chassis. We had a type 1 15 years ago, plus it was before Chief Gary was the chief, was on a Ford two-wheel drive chassis. We had a type 1, okay? We've been type 3 since then. So we're proposing going to the type 1 again. What? We want to replace the 2003 Ford Econoline chassis. It's an E450. That's not really, they're all E450s we've had. This one's a V10 gas. It's known as 37A1. As of this time frame, it has about 41,500 miles. Last night when I did the paperwork, I think it had 41 and change, 41.5, and 1,850 some hours on it, so, okay. Another picture I just want to show you about type 1s in the area. That's a picture of Henniker's type 1. Type 1 has a pickup truck chassis, vice the van chassis. Why I'm proposing going to a type 1 chassis? Added safety for both the patient and also my members. It's a four-wheel drive chassis. It's larger, it's more bulkier. Added expected lifespan. Like I said, we've been turning them over 4 to 5 years. We're proposing buying it on a Ram. I have it in here what it's going to be. It's a Ram chassis, four-wheel drive, with a Cummins diesel. We get out of the gas. Ford, over the last few years, has gotten out of the diesel market in the vans. We couldn't get a diesel in that van chassis, and that's why we went with the gas. Chevy did have the option, and I don't want to start a fight in town between Chevy, Ford, and Dodge, or whoever's better, but Chevy had one. And from talking to other department, one other ambulance service that had a Chevy chassis, they weren't happy with the suspension portion of it. And that leads into the decision also to go and go up to a type 1 chassis. The E450 that we currently have, the 2013 that gas chassis, the suspension is not nearly as heavy duty as it was in the previous diesel version. And you could feel it. And you could also probably come up with the metrics on tire wear. We replace tires pretty frequently on it, and it's probably because of the suspension just near the max for that vehicle. The type 1 that we're proposing is heavier duty than the van chassis. It's, like I said, it's a one-ton pickup truck, one-ton chassis, okay? Also proposing to change over in 2017 to take care of that 4 to 5 year problems. I could tell you with the 2008, when we went up between 4 and 5 years, we had turbo problems. We had a transmission issue that I went back to the dealer for. The 2008 also went back for air conditioning issues. That last summer, we had some touch and go issues with air conditioning. You know, picking up a patient when it was warm, it's warm in the summer. The air conditioning don't work on a rig. It's really not good for the patient to be back in the box there. We ended up taking up to Lewiston, Maine to get it fixed because that's the person who could do the fittings for it, okay? But that happened during the 4 to 5. Extended operating cycle, I think realistically we can get at least 6, maybe more years out of this one-ton vehicle than we would out of the van, just because of
of the heavier duty aspect of it, okay? That's a picture of Biddeford, Maine. They just took delivery. That's probably the newest one in the southern Maine, New Hampshire area. That's Biddeford, Maine's type one.
So, Chief, just mitigate the maintenance?
Yep.
Where do you see the...
Tire wear issue on our current one. Like I said, historically, since I've been chief, we're in about my 10th, 11th year. This is the third ambulance. I've seen mechanical issues arise in that fourth and fifth year when we try to extend it. This is a gas model, which we haven't had a gas model since probably the first ambulance in town here, okay? That's type maintenance issues, okay?
What do you mean by gas model?
The engine, it's a V10 gas engine. Like I said, Ford did not offer a diesel in that chassis in 2000.
Okay. Versus diesel, got it.
Correct, yeah, correct. Okay. It's a gas engine, yes.
Yeah.
Correct. When? Ordered after March meeting as soon as possible if the warrant article is approved. And delivery, excuse me, is 6 months. That's usually, I think it was 6 months after you received the order, okay? So that's where we're looking for delivery. So we order it in March, April timeframe. We'll have it before winter time, okay? That's a picture of, I don't think it's Meredith, it's up in the Lakes region. That's one that was delivered. It's on a Ford chassis. Who? We're recommending going with PL Custom. That's the manufacturer. The manufacturer's out of New Jersey. The dealer is out of Maine. It's Sugarloaf is the dealer. We've purchased the last three ambulances from this dealer. They have quite a reputation and a history, personal history with our department. Their maintenance is second to none, okay? When we need parts or any, you know, their service, they're there. They're there. He really takes care of his customers, okay?
So is that what it would look like?
That's a Ford chassis. That's Northwood's Ford chassis. It would look like that. That's Biddeford's. It would look like that in red. That's Barnstead's. That's a Dodge. That's the one that was stolen up in Concord a couple weeks ago. I don't know if you read the paper.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And there's another one in here. There's another one I have in here. That's on a Ford, so. Okay, we purchased the last three ambulances, the 3, the 8, and the 13 from PL Custom.
So I get, this is more curious than anything. So are the dealers like that scarce that there's none that are great in New Hampshire?
PL Custom, he is the only PL Custom for the region.
Okay, so it's more of a regional thing?
Yeah, for the
okay.
region.
All right.
Excuse me one second, I forgot I had more props for y'all. This is November 20th. This is just some sketches for like UPGs or whatever.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
The patient compartment box is just about identical. It's identical in size to what we currently have. The insides are laid out identically. There's three different changes. I don't want to get into that. One of them is a what's the name of the company that makes the locks, the phone activated locks, what do you call it?
Knox.
It's a Knox. Thank you. I'm bad at names. Knox is the manufacturer. There's a narcotic safe in there that's made by Knox that's electronic. We do have a paramedic on our staff, right? On our roster, uh-huh. On a call department. And so we need something of that magnitude. A couple of other shelf differences that were received from the input of members, little changes here and there. But other than that, the compartment and the layout, patient compartment's the same. We found that this works the best for us. That's why it's basically the same interior design as we've had for the last three models. And we like the way PL Custom does it. That's why, you know, compared to the other manufacturers.
So you basically buy a shell and then PL Custom outfits it exactly to the way that you guys want.
Correct. They buy directly from dealer, Dodge, Ford, whatever.
Okay.
They buy a chassis And PL Custom builds the box, does the lights and electronics,
oh, okay,
whatever, and hooks it up.
They actually build the back part.
Yep, and you'll see on some of them, you'll see I noticed in here about there's a $1,000, not credit, $1,000 deduction, $1,000 refund. There's a reduction in price of $1,000 when we order, and this is what we've been doing, if we pay for the chassis at delivery.
Okay.
So when we order it, we pay for the chassis. In the past, it was around $33,000. I could look up this one. I bet it's going to be a little more because it's a heavier-duty chassis. We pay that up front so that they're not covering, you know, the company.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
part of the contract.
Yeah, yeah.
And you get a $1,000 discount. That's it on the purchase price. Okay. So some history I could ramble through here is the 2008. When we purchased the 2008, the sale price was $148,000 and change. That was an E450. The 2003 that we traded in, we got $20,000. That's part of also the strategy why we want to extend the life. As you'll see, the trade-in values are obnoxious. Okay, you don't get that much. Mm-hmm. The delivery price was $128,000. And also part of that ambulance, we bought a new power cot, which was a separate warrant article, and that works into the story here. That cot cost $12,000. The stretcher was $12,000 for that ambulance. That's a picture of New Boston's Ford. It's on a Ford chassis. The 2013 ambulance we purchased, you can see the price, was $172,000. It was on a 13 Ford E450. We got $30,000 trade-in showing on paper for the 2008. The delivery price was $142,000, almost $143,000. Also part of this purchase is we upgraded our defibrillator to a LifePak 15. I just want to show you about the outfitting portion, and that was $35,000 additionally out of the ambulance operating fund. So we go here to the 17, that's a picture of our 08. Yeah, that was the one we traded in. That was our 08 right there. The price of a 2017 on a Ram 4500 4x4 chassis, 17 chassis, is almost $193,000. Okay. With the 13, right now we're quoted trading the 13 in up to 55,000 miles because we did talk about prorating. We put about 1,000 miles a month on that ambulance. The trade-in value would be $27,432. And with the prepaid discount of $1,000, that's what I was talking about, we pay up front for the chassis. Complete outfitting, we're talking about replacing a cot and rolling a cot inside there. A replacement cot this time is $17,500, okay? The current cot, like I said, we have is 2008. We almost 10 years old on that stretcher. The stretcher is electric hydraulic. I don't know if you folks are familiar. It picks up a maximum of 700 pounds. Battery operated, hydraulic, saves backs. But the one we have there has over 2,000 transports on it. If you just do 200, a year or whatever, based on the metrics, it's transported at least 2,000 patients. We had it refurbished, sort of, 2 years ago. Took care of a couple of the issues. It was starting to, hydraulically drift and things like that. It's starting to show its wear, so. We're proposing is replacing that as part of the outfitting for this one, along with a radio system. In the past, we've used the same Motorola Astro Grant radios. We just had them reinstalled. They were part of the PL Custom would install them when they come over. Those radios are no longer in production, nor are there parts for them. So we're talking about upgrading and replacing the radio system in there. So it's also including that price. So we're talking about a $220,000 ambulance fully outfitted with a new cot and a radio system.
Can you get anything for the cot?
$800 is what I was quoted for a trade-in, about $800. And I think, realistically, parts is parts. It may be that $800 value might be more for us to keep it for parts or as a spare than it is to trade it in, especially, pieces and parts aren't cheap in the medical area in these days, so maybe better to save it for parts, okay? And I'll do whatever you folks say. So how are we proposing to buy it? Fully funded from the ambulance billing fund. My last conversation was there's approximately $360,000 in that fund, so we'll cover the purchase of it. Mm-hmm. And it'll be no additional cost to the taxpayers. The photo there shows PL Custom transferring equipment between the 2008 and 2013 rigs. That's why you see two of the same one in our station. That's the only time you'll see two ambulances there. So that's the how. And that was delivery. That was delivery day back in October 1st, 2013. Okay. Questions?
So we got that delivered the end of 2000.
October 1st, 2013, this was delivered.
And we would get the new one October 2000.
Six months on top of order. If we order it by the first of April, meetings March, by the time it'd be the same time frame. Sometime in October, it should be for the winter. 6 months is what they'll quote at this time, obviously for contractual reasons, okay?
And the other towns that have the Dodge chassis?
Yep.
Like it?
Well, I'll tell you what, our department has a personal history with Dodges. Our department has, this is our second Cummins, our utility is a Dodge Cummins. Some of our members, I've had two, and my deputy chief's had two Cummins. We're, okay, as far as reliability, okay, that's like it, okay. I didn't answer your question because I haven't heard any issues with it, okay. So I'm saying, you know, we're going to get into Dodge, Ford kind of preferences. You know, our department's had two Dodge, two Ram Cummins so far. We haven't had any issues with either
for of them. For the utility truck.
Utility, and our forestry back in the 80s was a Cummins back. Our first forestry we had was a first generation Dodge Ram Cummins
vehicle. We had that until 05.
We had that until 05, okay. And that was like an 88 or something like that. We purchased that about 88.
So I think one of the questions that I get the lifespan,
yep,
and how that can save the town money over time. One of the questions that's going to come up is, isn't diesel more expensive, and how much is that going to cost the town on a yearly basis?
We'd have to talk about the difference between rack prices. I don't know what the delta is, what the town pays for diesel, but. Okay.
Yeah, I mean that's going to be a question that gets asked.
In mileage and comparable, I do have mileage on here and stuff. We're getting about 6 miles to the gallon with our current rig. I think it shows six on the computer, six miles to the gallon with the gas rig. Okay. What do I expect with the other one? I don't know. We get in the teens with a pickup truck chassis. Okay, I don't know what we would get for mileage on this one. This is going to be four wheel drive also.
6 miles to the gallon.
The Econoline that we have right now, but six.
How big is the tank?
Close to 50, like 45 okay. gallon or so.
Okay.
Yeah.
The other question I had was, so this is a, the new one is a type one. What we've had now is type three.
Correct.
Okay, and in, I forget what year you said, but we had a type one. We went to type three.
Correct.
And what was the rationale there?
I'll tell you what, that was grossly underpowered, I'll give you right now. That was the first generation, like a Ford chassis with diesel, non-turbo.
Sure.
That was one of the, I think they backfitted a turbo on it, trying to get power out of it, because that thing was anemic, I remember. And it was two-wheel drive also.
But what was the thinking at the time?
I wasn't part of the
Okay. Executive
committee at that time, so okay. I don't know. That was during... Chief Chase's tenure.
Okay.
I don't know what the thinking was on that.
Okay.
That was, there might have been a second ambulance that we had in town. I'm trying to think. It wasn't, the first ambulance we had was a van type, which I don't want to confuse. It was a type two.
Okay.
And that may have been the second ambulance that we had in the town there. That was a Ford chassis, two-wheel drive. And I know, from what I understand, it was power issues. The thing was,
okay,
it was grossly underpowered.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you another reason why we're steering it. I don't want to start a battle with it. Ford, to me, I don't think they got their act together with diesels. They've been changing their diesel engine every year or two in their pickup truck or utility vehicle line. They've been going between internationals and Ford diesels, changing the displacements up and down the whole thing. They've got problems with head bolts and everything else. I want to steer clear of Ford. We have a Ford. We have a 2005 Ford. Forestry, but I think the Cummins is a more reliable, proven powertrain.
And
that's why we're going there.
Other questions, you guys?
Now, where, again, you say there'll be no impact to the taxpayers, which, but I mean, taking that amount of money out of your fund, is that going to affect the way that you guys operate, or are you going to be okay, or?
Since 2007, that fund was originally established to pay for replacement ambulance. Since 2007, we've expanded through town meeting the use of that fund to pay our operating expenses. And right now it covers everything except manpower, labor charges. It covers our fuel. It covers our supplies that aren't provided by the hospital. It covers what else? Maintenance, like the tires I talked about for that ambulance. It's also purchased some of the equipment, like that life pack, defibrillator, the previous cot it's purchased. We're talking about expanding its role this year for covering training and licensing expenses for the EMS personnel also. I can't predict what we're gonna collect for billing every year. So far it's been solvent. It's something that I've been managing. We've been managing every, you know, closely. We've been able to pay those expenses for the last 10 years. We've saved over $100,000. I think we're probably in the range of $120,000 in expenses. We pull out about $25,000 a year to cover those expenses. The short answer is no, I don't expect. Typically, we pull in about $60,000. It also pays for our billing service. I forgot about that. And it pays for our ALS service out of it. We pull in about $60,000 a year. Okay, that's typically, but I can't predict where we're at. So 60,000 times four, we'd have over 200,000 back in there. We're gonna leave probably 100,000 at least in there. Okay, it's 140 really. We'd have enough to replace this ambulance in 4 years like planned and pay for the expenses. That's part of my job, is part of the budget to see if that is going south. Then I need to, you know, we need to go back to the previous way of doing it, is putting in our operating budget. Like I said, I don't feel that pulling 220 out of there is going to affect that. I think we could recover over the 4 to 6 years of the lifespan, or even more, and we'd have enough to replace the ambulance again, like it originally, that fund was originally earmarked for. And that's the primary goal, is to make sure that when we do go to buy another ambulance, that we're not coming to the town and saying, hey, we need another 200, by that time it'd be 250 to three, you know, $250,000 rig. So that would be the primary. The other operating expenses, and you've probably seen it in my budget, and I'm babbling a lot here, for the ambulance, is 2025, I think we pulled this year, what, you have paper in front of you, 26,000 or so out of there a year.
Where are we? 20, we have it at 25,
but we've never reached that limit. That money goes back into that fund. We've always had enough to cover it. So I don't foresee that really. Mike, right here with the call metrics, that was my backup slide. You can see where we're at there with medical aids. This past calendar year, we're up to 278, and you look over it, we're at a high point. So the call volume has been increasing. Okay, so
thank you.
And I can't predict who's, you know.
Okay. All set. All right. Thank you very much for coming in.
No problem. Sorry we're late. Okay.
You were right on time.
Okay. Any other questions? Let me know, Chris. You know, should I pull this out? Just yank it, or F for it?
Yeah, that's fine. Just pull it out. We'll.
Thanks.
Thank you. All right, Chris, what's next?
Budget. You've had lots of looks at the budget. You have a summary sheet of where we sit right now. Nothing's changed since the last time you looked at it, but this is just a summary of the whole thing. And the revenues that I sent, and I think you have another printout of it.
Yeah.
No drastic changes in revenues, and I outlined a few of those things, the lesser changes, in email for you. We're trending right in the lines that really matter, all registration. rooms and meals tax and highway grant from the state, those are the three biggest ones. We've been really conservative on those historically, and there's no reason not to be conservative. This number doesn't really mean much.
Yep.
In the grand scheme of things, it moves the estimated tax impact that we present to the voters. The more revenue you project, the smaller the tax impact of the budget.
Right, right. The but more disappointed people are if it doesn't come in.
Yeah. But when it comes time to actually turn revenues into a tax rate, we have actual numbers that we use, or late year projections that we use. So this doesn't really mean too much. But we do need to present it to the voters as part of the budget. So the only kind of change in philosophy is around motor vehicle registrations. We have historically and consistently been well under budget on that, and Charlie used to do that, and I did it 3 years ago because we were still mid-recession then, and mm-hmm. it was hard to trust that those numbers were going to be that stable. But what we see is a continuing increase in that line. The fee structure hasn't changed. This is just more vehicles being purchased and processed. So I projected a number closer to what we're actually taking in, not projecting a crazy increase or even capturing all the increase that we have seen, just trying to be a little more accurate and realistic in what we expect to pull out of that. So, and there's probably smaller numbers that move in there, which I can talk you through if you want to see them. You know, building permits are a tough one to guesstimate. You don't know when that start. You know, houses are going to start. I've pulled the interest and penalties on delinquent taxes back quite a bit. As our unpaid tax total goes down, as it has been, people are paying taxes, more of the taxpayers are keeping up with their,
yep.
That decreases that interest and penalty liability that the taxpayers carry and we take advantage of through fees. So
yep.
As that number goes down, I think that's an economic story too, you know. We should anticipate less of that revenue.
Yep.
So I pulled
yep.
that number back quite a bit.
Okay.
And everything else is kind of small.
Okay.
So if you take that number, one change that I don't think was in the thing that they sent you electronically, but we're going to need to reflect the ambulance purchase down at the bottom there in the transfer lines. As we move money from the various funds, we'll have to present that differently, but that doesn't actually impact the tax number at all. So that will look different when it goes to the press. But then on the expense side, you have the total sheet here that reflects that revenue number and projects a tax burden based on all that. I have one more expense to discuss that is not incorporated here. I mentioned, I think at our last meeting, maybe two meetings ago, we were having trouble with our fire alarm in this building.
Right.
The panel dates to probably the original renovation, if not sooner. It's old enough that we can't really get parts for it. It's been band-aided a few times.
Mm-hmm.
Power surge a couple weeks ago wreaked some more havoc, and they found a piece that had been left over from another thing and made it work and got it all working again. So we have fire protection, alarm protection at this point. With the next surge in power, I suspect that we will be back in the same place and not have a part to fix it. So I'd like to replace that alarm panel, which is the one right inside the front door here. It covers both this side of the building and the police station. and we got a quote from our primary vendor on that for $2,600, I believe it is. Right?
Yep.
$2,500, $2,500, something like that. Yep. That is something we could, you could decide to take out of that ETF that sits there for maintenance purposes if you so desired, or we still have time to stick it into the budget for 2017, and it's not that much, and I thought, well, let's, you know, we have a few thousand bucks in that account that's really, I think, earmarked more for the heating system in this building, but it would, you know, I'd like to keep that dry for an emergency when we don't have an opportunity to, to do that. So, I'd like to put that in the 17 budget. That discussion flushed out our a second problem that has been ignored for a long time, and that's the second invoice sheet that you have there, and that's the camera system in the police department. When the police station was built or relocated here and created there, they put cameras in, and it's very common in police stations to have cameras for a few things. Recording interactions between arrestees and officers, recording stuff for court purposes, you know, how people behave in the police station is often used in trial proceedings. You know, you could dream up all kinds of things, but and also a more current use, but something that our officers think about, is what's outside the door when they leave the building. There's been ambushes at police stations, so we had a system installed that recorded the sally port, the processing room, the interview room, and the outside of the sally port, and the lobby and the police department, and the front entrance of the police department. Those cameras are all still there. You may notice one of them hanging on the ceiling out there. 6 years ago, maybe, or so, it stopped working, and we haven't had one since. So we don't have any of that kind of
anywhere.
We have nothing. Yeah.
What's the sally port?
Sally port's where you drive in the cruiser with somebody in custody.
Oh, okay.
So you get inside the security perimeter of the building, okay, and can move them, okay, within the building without,
okay,
taking them outside.
Got it. How often do they bring people here?
Most arrests will pass through here. Okay. And we also do interviews that aren't arrests, but they're interviews that are recorded. Right now, our primary recording device is one of those old school digital audio things from 7 or 8 years ago that you know, little battery operated digital audio recording. We don't have any video recording capability for our interviews. So, the technology, we might be able to make what we have, the cameras that we have, work again. The recording portion of our system is pretty well shot, and the technology has changed so much in this arena in the 8 or 10 years since it died, 6 years since it died, and the 12 years since it was installed. It doesn't make any sense to try and fix what we have. It's cheaper to just replace it if we're going to add that capability back in. What this is a digital video recorder, just like you may have at home for your TV. Works the same way. Motion activated. It would record all of those areas that I listed whenever there's any kind of motion or activity, and retain it for, I think, 30 days. Typically, we know that we need it the next morning, and you know, the officer, if say we have an arrest, an officer can, you know, with his or her mouse, just go grab the recording of that, you know, DWI processing or whatever, and plunk it right in the in the arrest file electronically, so.
In this day and age, too, does something like this give the give the police officers the kind of the record of their behavior?
Absolutely.
In situations.
Yeah. And you've seen, there was a case in Hampton that where that video was instrumental in an assault, a charge of an assault by an officer.
Yep.
But yes, it would fully protect us from a false claim of, the guy roughed me up or whatever.
Yep. Yep.
We would have pretty much a recording of from the moment the cruiser pulls up to the door to the moment every interaction with the individual.
Would this be two separate items or just one?
We can treat them separately. The alarm system is something that I think we really need to do sooner rather than later. We're gonna be up against we have to act or we're not gonna have a fire alarm in the building on that side.
$8,000. I mean, I think
The camera side. These are separate. They're related, but they're separate. We've lived without the cameras for years, so.
It's 2017, there could be repercussions on us too if something ever did happen and we didn't have any device or whatever, it could be issues.
So the interview room system is a little different in that it has audio capability. The rest of it is just video.
Yeah.
So that's what that distinction is there. And you can, obviously an interview, a video and audio recording of an interview is invaluable in a criminal
sure.
case.
Yeah,
you can see how I need to explain that. But.
So I think I'm in favor of putting them both in the budget, assuming that's what you're looking for.
Yeah, well, that's, and then I can keep going too, beyond this. We also talked about adding cameras. This, the core of this system, the recording core of the system, can handle a lot more cameras than what we're proposing here.
Okay.
And we had also kicked around putting cameras in the town clerk's office, of the counter, and in our office at the counter, and perhaps the lobby here, to, that's where our cash is. That is the, from a security point, that would, the town clerk's office or our office would be a target for either somebody who's not happy or somebody who wants money. That's a relatively small add-on piece for that. The camera itself is what?
So having the system in place, then we could add additional cameras.
We can add cameras for
The eight cameras that he's quoting in the one, is that all?
That's all PD.
Okay.
Yep. So we can add two or three more to that for $300 a piece. Have that. It's not going to, other than be a deterrent, it's not going to prevent anything.
Yeah.
But it could be a pretty significant deterrent. It could also be valuable for something else. So that's a wish, not a need.
Well, I mean, if you're talking about doing it, if you're talking about doing three more, it's $1,000 more.
Yeah, yeah, and in the terms of the setup and everything, it would all be the same price. So that's the.
Thoughts, you guys?
Well, do we put it in the operating budget or do we put it as a warrant article? Put the whole caboodle in the warrant article, or do we put it in the operating?
Well, I definitely want to put the fire. I definitely prefer to put the fire alarm system in the operating.
I think that's. I mean, that's definitely needed.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. We could do.
And I mean, the cameras are as well, and the police. Yeah. I can't believe that it's been 6 years.
I know exactly.
Let's just put everybody. At risk.
I know, right? I mean, there's two ways you can do it. You can put it in a warrant article.
Yeah.
Although, I mean, how do you feel about the need?
Either way, I mean, in the budget, that's fine.
But you think the need is significant?
Yeah, I think we need it. Yeah.
So there's two ways that we can go at it. Then we can say, look, we believe it so strongly that we want to put them both in the budget. And then, you know, there's separate line items in the budget, so the town meeting could still vote to reduce that line item, right?
I mean, I think some people that, I mean, if they knew that we didn't have it anyway, I mean, not, again, I'm thinking worst case scenario. I mean, the kids are over in there all the time. I mean, you got stuff going on here all the time. In today's world, you never know. I mean, it'd be best for us to have this kind of equipment, I believe.
But. Yeah, the only risk with breaking it out is no means no. So if you, if it was the camera piece was its own $6,000 question and it failed, and you found yourselves in November with $6,000 that you wanted to use on this, you couldn't do it.
Not in the budget.
No. If it was a standalone item, it was in the operating budget, you could still do that. But
right.
If it, as a standalone
warrant article,
if it failed, you'd be prohibited from doing anything like it.
And does this includes the installation?
Yeah.
And so when you say the extra cameras, that's just the cameras, or is that cameras and insulation for the additional cameras?
Insulation included.
That's not going to add any additional cost except for the camera itself.
Go for it.
Yeah, budget.
Okay. All right, so that will move the,
11 would be right.
9. Yeah, so the number that you see on your summary expense sheet will move by 9 or 10 or whatever it is.
And actually, if we cut, just if we take line,
going after welfare again?
Yep, you are. Yep. I tell you, we're still $5,000 more than what we should be.
You have a detail thing? You're just looking at the total?
No, looking at the total.
Which the one? Total is General Assistance Department, 4441.
Okay.
$11,000 is what's proposed.
Yes.
Well,
I tell you, if you average it out over the years, it's way more than what we've
got an argument there.
6,000.
I mean, what are you suggesting? I mean, we're putting in, what do we say, $9,000?
Yeah, ish, yeah.
Ish?
Yeah.
7 grand?
So if you look at, like, and this was about the average. For like when I looked at it like 2-3 years ago, the average was $4,000 is what was getting spent. I don't think we should go as low as that because we just did 6,
mm-hmm.
right? But to do where we are, and I know that Chris already cut it once, but I mean, we could cut that a little bit more. Maybe we don't cut it up 5, but maybe we cut it down a little bit so then it just kind of.
If we bring it down to 7,000,
yeah,
it's like could have 4,000 up a million,
yeah.
I'm okay with that given the averages.
You want to make that what, 7 even?
7 even, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I said before that the what we budget in this line has absolutely nothing to do with what we spend. If somebody meets the criteria that we've set up and they have no other options and we got to pay this cost, we're going to pay this cost. You can't say there's no money in the budget. You can't,
exactly.
That's illegal. So it's an estimating process more than a spending limitation process or spending minimum. We're not going to spend it if we don't need it. So,
okay. All right.
You can make that number whatever you want. It's not going to change what we actually spend.
Yeah.
Okay. That's fine.
Okay. So I'll make that, I'll divvy that up wherever it makes sense and make that come out to be around 7K. Round number 7,000. Yes.
7.
Yep.
Yeah. Good.
Okay. That is it for the budget. I will update all this stuff and send it to you before we march into the budget committee with it. But we're
headed
that
way.
And that's this Thursday.
Okay.
Yep.
Now, when you guys, I can set with you guys this week, right? Instead of setting on the budget committee.
No, you're stuck up here. Yeah.
Just sit here.
I was just wondering. No problem.
All right.
Okay. Last item on the agenda, anything else you want to do?
Before we go into non-public, did you have anything else, Charlene?
No, I was just looking over the, excuse me, the warrant articles.
Oh, yeah, I gave you, or Dawn included in there, the warrant article thing. The only nothing's really changed here, other than I wanted you to think about the order in which they fall at the meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I took one stab at it, and you don't have to make this decision now. You got a couple of meetings left, but, you know, we're going to, some of these numbers will move just a little bit. The tax impact number's pretty good. We know what those are going to be, with the exception of the operating budget, and we'll see what comes out of the committee and if it moves there. But this is where we have the order right now. And take a look at it, let me know your thoughts on when you want to tackle what.
Okay.
And we can do that offline if you
and
want.
Have you talked to Revision Energy about, are they going to come and do at town meeting?
Or? They're ready to do that, yes.
I want to see whatever they're going to present before they present it, because just how cumbersome that.
Yep.
Yeah, and I had a discussion with them, and I need to have an offline with you about the mortgage subordination question. And I went back to him and said, let's cut this all down, and he's going to give me another draft of that monster document that you got to try and make it easier to understand. And you'll see that before we go to town meeting with it.
Okay, so then I just got a couple quick things.
Go ahead.
So you had sent us the Lampard River Association minutes or meetings or something like that, so keep doing that. Just so we know it's being discussed. The Chris Pappas sent in his office. Did we want to put that in the town report or not?
Have we ever done that?
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
I didn't find it like anything earth shattering.
No, I didn't either.
Yeah.
I don't even have a rep on that committee right now. I've put a posting on the board.
For the Lamprey River. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Was anyone of us thinking about going to the assessing training that Sue sent us?
It's during the day.
No, it's on a Saturday, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
No?
No, I
don't. No, that's a Tuesday,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, it's
oh, okay.
Day things.
And then we got that petition request from Sugar Hill.
Yeah, I saw it.
On Northern Pass.
They wanted you to include a warrant article about
HB 145, yeah.
Yeah.
I missed that.
That was the is that the one where the municipality has to approve any sighting?
Yes,
of,
yes.
Yeah, so they are soliciting probably every town and city in the state to advocate for that piece of legislation, which would require municipal approval for the sighting of any
utility, wasn't it?
Utility, okay. Distribute, I don't know if it's T&D or transmission. Yeah.
Was it specific to transmission?
Yeah.
I can get you the text of the bill and the request from the folks in Sugar Hill, and
yeah,
you can
okay.
decide. There's often noise like that about please do this at town meeting from somebody,
yep.
and I think that's
yep.
the only piece we've had this year. But.
Yeah. All right. It was just kind of things that have come into us that I just
yeah.
wanted to touch base on that. Yeah. All right.
Okay. All right. We're going to go into non-public. Is it J?
Yep. Trying to think if there's a piece of it that we might do publicly. You 2 weeks ago said what you wanted to happen if the sale didn't go through. And 2 weeks ago you said if the sale doesn't go through, let's file for taking my tax deed.
Yep.
Yep.
You have. Well.
J is the right one.
Oh,
because
J. Okay.
J is specific to item 6, which is. I'll clarify some of that information. So yes, it is confidential.
We're looking for the one where we can discuss advice from legal counsel. The new section added to 91A. Anyway, 2 weeks ago you said publicly that that's what we want to do.
Yeah.
You have a draft of that filing, and it, if it hasn't been filed already, it will be first thing in the morning.
Okay.
That will generate other rounds of other filings or other things that we need to discuss in non-public because it's around negotiating those things. So that is the setup for the non-public session tonight. I don't think you will come out of non-public with any decisions to announce.
Okay.
So you can close with that.
And then once it, you know it's filed, will you update the website?
Yeah, and that we will actually, that at the same time that filing happens, we will get a hearing date for when that motion will be heard.
Okay.
And I will post that information as well.
Okay.
How far in advance, how far out do you think that will be?
It's not official until it's official, but it's going to be February 21st.
Okay. Huh? Interesting.
That's what it looks like now, but we can't be certain of that until we actually, you know, push the enter key on the filing. So that much can be public.
Okay.
For tonight until tomorrow morning, and we will go more public with all of that with our posting tomorrow.
Okay.
So we need what section?
L?
It's either going to be L or potentially D, the buy, sell, lease property.
No, it's L. L is the new one. That,
yeah.
All right. I'll make a motion that we go into non-public per RSA 91-3:32L.
Second.
All in favor, roll call.
Tyler Eaton.
Charlene Anderson.
Donna Danis. All right, we'll be we'll be ending the meeting when we come out of non-public, and there will be no other business discussed. So thank you, and stay safe and stay warm.
Drive careful.
Stay warm.